have drawback claimants, and claimants are usually the parties which are entitled to claim the drawback. And keep in mind there are various players, and by the time the product is exported, it went through the importer, it usually went through the manufacturer or some kind of merchandiser that sells and buys products and ships them overseas. And it went through the transportation of companies, intermediaries, middlemen, middlewomen, middle persons. And so even though one party may wear the same hat, the rest, you still must be mindful that there are different players involved. And because there are different players involved, you have to know who has a basic right to claim the drawback. So the starting point is to understand that the exporting party, the party who exports the product, is not the only party that can make that claim. It is also the party that destroys the product. Remember, the product does not have to be only exported. And I think when we spoke about the rejected merchandise drawback, we mentioned that part, that the product can also be destroyed to qualify for the refund of duties. So, and this may make sense, but sometimes you may not be able to export the stuff altogether because there is some kind of legal requirements. Let's say the product has been deemed as not safe. So you may not be able to export it out, or at least legally speaking, because it doesn't comply with various safety requirements. But you already brought it in and you paid the duty for, so it may not be a good idea for you to export it to other places. It may be just easier for you to destroy it and avoid those penalties as a part of agreement with various agencies, such as Consumer Product Safety Commission, for example. And this is a real thing. If those of you who go to the department stores like Walmart, let's say, will see that like there is a board, and there is always some kind of recall notices out there. And those recall notices relate to the safety requirements. And what happens to those products, right? I have seen some of those products destroyed. Because in part of the safety issue, so this stuff happens. All right, now, so let's take a look at the players. So we have several players. The chart specifies goes by the type, manufacturing, unused, and rejected, and goes by the player, right? So you have exporter, destroyer, manufacturer, producer, intermediate party, and importer, right? The default is. For any type of drawback, exporter and destroyer are the parties that are entitled to claim the drawback automatically. All the other parties, the gray shaded area means not applicable. All the other parties can be entitled to claim the product, but they have to get the assignment rights. All right. They have to get the assignment rights, and because of that, there is documentation requires that shows the demonstration. Remember that certificate of manufacturing delivery that I was talking about, which is no longer a requirement. So documentation must show the chain of custody, the transfer of title, and the right to an ability for the party who claims the drawback to be able to show the eligibility for the monies that the exporter or the destroyer has assigned to that particular party. All right, now, so importer is a default yes for the rejected merchandise drawback, and the reason for the rejected merchandise drawback is because it's usually the importing party who comes in and and remember, we talked about that sample specification requirement where you got the smiley face, but it was upside down. So, picking off on that example, it's not going to, the importer will usually be a grief party, and the importer will usually be the party who says, okay, I don't want this stuff, I'm shipping it back. So you importer, given the specificity of this rejected merchandise drawback situation, the importer would be usually the one that is also the acting as an exporter. In other cases, such as the manufacturing drawback, it would be the other way around. It would not be usually the importer, because the importer and manufacturer, although sometimes are the same, they are usually different parties. Which party has the right to claim drawback under the provision of direct identification drawback, right? So here we have direct identification drawback. What did they say, manufacturing or not? I don't think so. So direct identification can apply to two scenarios, right? It can be either manufacturing or it can be unused merchandise. And it can either imply, here's the picture. It's before we even dive into this, we know that it's direct identification. And if this can imply manufacturing, or it can imply unused merchandise. Further, this is one criteria. Number two criteria, it can also imply that the product is either destroyed or exported. So it can be either or. As we go through these elements, right, we know that if those elements fit, then we have a right answer. And it can be a combination of those elements. But in order to analyze, we have to have this kind of mental picture. Or if you're out there, it makes it easier. You can write it out as you're going through the analysis of this particular question. So let's go back to the question. Okay, which party has the right to? So we're talking about direct identification. We're talking about right to claim drawback. And going to our chart, we know that the right, unless assigned, for direct identification is given to the exporter or destroyer, or we're talking about direct identification, so yes, it would be only those two. So the exporter, so the third one, the default, right, is the exporter or destroyer, and in parentheses I would say unless assigned. All right. So let's go through the list and check out which one fits the bill. So an importer who imports merchandise and sells it to another company, that then exports it. All right. So an importer is not a default party. So A is incorrect. An importer who delivers imported duty paid merchandise to another company under certificate of delivery, and the merchandise is then exported. So there is no assignment here. And we know it must be the exporter or destroyer. So B, after you read this and you see there is no assignment, you can cross the B out also. C, a broker who obtains a CBP form 4811. Huh, interesting, 4811. So CBP form 4811. So as you, it is very helpful as we go, as you go through those drills, as you prepare for the customs broker exam, you know what's going on, because sometimes the stuff they take you from, they take from this particular suggested answer can be relevant in other answers. So how do you know? Well, how do you know what form and what it is used for? Or in other words, what is there any easy way to look it up? One easy way to look it up is there is a textbook, second volume of the textbook, last chapter devoted to forms. It's a compilation of various forms which customs examiners test on the exam. Since we're preparing, everyone has access to the internet. So what we'll do is we go to cbp.gov, and the Customs and Border Protection, who CBP wants you, sounds like this Uncle Sam, World War I logo. I want you. Let's see. On the bottom, they have the section for forms. And the one way to do it is just type 4811 and see what it is. So 4811 for special address information. Yeah, let me open it up in the new tab, and you'll see why in a bit. All right, so this is what we're talking about. This is a form. Special address notification, right? What you have here, it's also connected to 5106. It's also connected to the form 7501. Because sometimes you may want someone else, as an importer or even as a licensed customs broker, you may want someone else to handle the financial part, not the submission part, not the procedural part, but the financial part. So you may want to have your bills, refunds, or notices to be handled by a CPA, let's say, or that third-party consultant. This means that you are kind of like outsourcing it to a third party. And since the form, since customs is dealing with importer or record or licensed customs broker, and that third party shows up on the scene all of a sudden, then customs established that procedure of saying, okay, we'll take that third party into the consideration. However, you must follow protocol, sign it, make it official, so that party is also part of the game. So how does that party become part of the game can be easily seen through the CBP form 7501, because which is an entry summary, very popular form, will be tested on the customs broker exam, as it has been for the in many of the past exams. All right. Now, so this form has this block. Block 24, reference number, right? What do you put in that block 24? You put in the one party for whom you filled out this special address notification, right? So this form, the form 4811, relates to 7501. Customs will know that for the reference number purposes to have that third party identifier, and here as we can see in the block 24, customs has a record, IRS, IN, so employee ID number, social security, CBP assigned number for individual or a firm, like CPA, to whom refunds, bill, or notice of extension or suspension are to be sent, in other words, the form 4811, which was properly and duly filled out. So here is the relationship of reference number to the form 4811 and how it plays out. So going back to the question that we are analyzing, a broker who obtains a CBP form 4811 from the importer who currently owes the broker for services rendered if that importer sells the imported merchandise to another company. So the broker says, okay, send the money to me, the money which you owe to me, so I get this money. That's a problem for the broker because the money belongs to the client, right? But that's a separate issue. The broker files a claim on the export merchandise to recoup some of his losses, right? Form 4811 is a reference, it's not the assignment. The money that belongs to the importer, right, is that importer's money, right? That's number one. Number two, the importer sells the imported merchandise to another company, which then exports it. So the importer is not the default authorized person because it is the exporter, another company, which is default authorized person, provided that the appropriate transfer of and the chain of custody is established. So the broker who files a claim, he should, I don't care, and customs doesn't care what about his losses. He is not an appropriate party because Form 4811 establishes the person who would manage that person's money, not take ownership for once. And for number two, is in the context of duty drawback, it is irrelevant because it is the default party is the exporter, not the importer, making C an incorrect answer choice. All right, so going to D. Company A, which destroys the... Oh, okay, so we have Company A, we have a fact of destruction under CBP supervision after obtaining from the importer of record after obtaining the merchandise from the importer record along with the certificate of delivery. So we know the default party is a destroyed and destroyer, right? So the merchandise was destroyed. The destroyer is the one which is a company A. So it's a default, it's an eligible party by default. And they obtained the proper chain of custody documents to show that they were entitled to make the destruction, and it was done under CBP supervision, so it was done on notice, making the procedural protocol duly followed. Therefore, answer D is the correct answer choice. E, company B, which receives the duty paid imported merchandise from the importer of record, manufactures it into the new and different article and sells it to the manufacturer B for further processing and subsequent export. All right, what's going on here? So company B is not the importer, right? They are the manufacturer, and they manufacture it in they make a different article of commerce, which is fine because the duty is claimed only on the important part which is used in that manufacture, right? So here is the interesting part. So you have company B and manufacturer B. That's confusing. I think what customs examiners are trying to say is that those are the different entities. You have company B and manufacturer B, right? Here, who is the default exporting party? We know that exporter or destroyer are default party. It looks like from the fact pattern that manufacturer B does further processing and subsequently acts as an exporter. And because of that, that party is a default party who is entitled to claim because it is the acting as an exporter. Company B, unlike manufacturer B, right, is in the middle. It didn't act as an importer and it didn't act as an exporter. And there is no evidence that it has received authorization because it needs authorization to or assignment to claim the drawback, which is a necessary prerequisite because company B is not the exporting party, not the destroying party, which is not the case here, making E an incorrect answer choice.